Welcome back to Rapid Fire, your weekly show, all things guns, freedom, Second Amendment, and self-defense. I'm really happy to have joining us on the live feed here is attorney Jason Guida. How are you today, Jason?
I'm great. Thank you very much. Good to be here.
Yeah, my pleasure. And it's always good to talk to you. And, you know, we get a ton of legal questions. I know I'm out there in the public space a lot on radio and on our podcast. And so people ask me legal questions. That's because I'm the gun guy and selling guns, and there's all kinds of questions around it. And I try to preface it with, I'm not an attorney, but this is what I think. But it's nice when we get an attorney and an expert on the line that can actually clear some stuff up for us. And one of the questions I got last week when I was hosting the Grace Curley Show was a caller said, look, I live in Boston area and I got a restricted license to carry. I was told I'll never be able to have it for concealed carry, just for target and hunting. And so in light of the Bruin case that came out from the Supreme Court, it sounded like the, you know, Massachusetts tried to fix all that and take that discretionary licensing habits of local police chiefs out of their hand and try to bring it in line with the Bruin decision. So my question is, A, does the guy's license automatically become an unrestricted license? Or, you know, and B, does he have to reapply and specifically say, I don't want it restricted? And so I figured I'd ask you and see if you had any insight on that.
No, you bet. So this was something obviously that we were dealing with a couple of months ago when the Bruin decision came down and the Executive Office of Public Safety reluctantly dragging their feet along with the AG's office finally said, look, you can't have restrictions anymore. FRB, the Firearms Records Bureau, has notified that they won't process licenses with restrictions. And then subsequent to that in August, the legislature amended the statute and removed the restriction language and removed the penalty for violating a restriction. Specifically with the city of Boston, what I can tell you is when Bruin happened and we started addressing the restrictions, you know, I was talking to Jim Wallace at the Gun Owners Action League, COM2A, trying to identify communities that were going to, were generally restriction communities and were going to fight us on this, right? So we were looking to make a case out of it. I spoke with the chief in Medford. I spoke with the licensing officer in Springfield, the licensing officer in Boston. All of them were like, look, that's the law now. We're not restricting licenses. With regard to Boston specifically, if this is a Boston specific question, the lieutenant there who's now in charge of licensing, very reasonable guy. What they did is they just said, call us or email us and we will have a new license printed for you. Don't need to reapply. I believe Medford, so that was a big restriction community, they went ahead and affirmatively had all of their licenses reprinted. Springfield, I think, was doing the same thing. So if you're in a community that's still, and there is still a few communities out there that still have on their website, you need to write a letter to the chief telling them why and this, and they still have a restriction policy in place. What I'm advising clients is this, you know, in theory, they can ask you for a reason, but you don't really have to answer them. What I generally do for my clients is on the application, I simply check the box, unrestricted, all lawful purposes, and write something along the lines of for self-defense and maintain proficiency at a range, something like that. So they can't say you didn't give them a reason, but they also can't deny you for that reason. Right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's just to avoid the bureaucracy of them saying, well, you didn't answer this question right, I'm denying you. It's much easier to just kind of put a little blurb in there than it is to not do it and then have to hire me to litigate it, right?
Yeah, I mean that. So my big question, I guess, along those lines is, if somebody doesn't do anything about it, they just leave the restrictions, but yet they're caught carrying a gun at the restaurant or 7-Eleven or, sure, you know, drive home from wherever, can they charge him with anything?
Right. So that's a really good question. I actually have on my desk, I have to be in court in about 2 weeks on a case where a guy, he was charged with violating his restriction prior to the Bruin case, but he didn't get a summons until after the Bruin case came down. So we're looking obviously to dismiss those charges. There should have been, you know, an advisory to law enforcement, and I believe there was an advisory to law enforcement. This is no longer a crime. However, that doesn't mean it wouldn't happen. I prefer, and I would advise somebody to say, look, you got to license this as target and hunting. Contact your licensing authority. Tell them you want a new license. And quite frankly, a lot of people just contacted the licensing authority and said it was lost or stolen. And you're entitled to a free replacement license when that happens. If your department is just not helping you, you know, if it gets lost, they have to replace it. And they'll print it and it'll have no restrictions on it because there's no restrictions anymore.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, that's that makes a lot of sense. The it was very frustrating to me how all the licensing agencies or officers, you know, the chief law enforcement officials in whatever town you live in and or are employed in or have a place of business in, you know, because you can apply where your place of business is. But how it was the wild, wild west. And some towns required live fire. Some towns required that you list a specific reason. And if you give a specific reason, they could say it wasn't good enough. They want another reason. Like that happened to me when I reapplied. I said, for any lawful purpose, they go, we don't accept that anymore. You got to give us another reason. So I'm like, well, doesn't for all lawful purpose, isn't that a big catch-all? Like that covers everything. Nope. You got to give us a specific reason for exercising your Second Amendment. So I was just frustrated that, and then you could jump through all the hoops. And in some cases you had to go to Moon Island and show a proficiency, you know, you had to somehow miraculously be able to shoot a 4-inch 38 special revolver at some pretty big distances and maintain a 70% proficiency under stress because you got a range safety officer sitting there with his scorecard. Right. In order to get a license to carry for target and hunting, you know, it's unbelievable. And, but there was, so I guess that comes down to the, you know, it's like a, what do they call it when the state has like preemption, like it's a preemption type of thing, right? Like the state rules don't override the local chief law enforcement agency who can seemingly make up his own rules, right?
So prior to the amendment in August in Bruin, the statute said that the applicant must show a good reason to fear injury to person or property. And now every department had a different interpretation of what that meant. And look, I know you nor your listeners are going to have any sympathy for the licensing officers that had to implement that. But I can tell you, you know, I was a licensing officer when I worked for the state for non-residents. Interpreting that and applying some sort of across-the-board policy was very difficult. It's extremely subjective. What the heck is a good reason? Some departments would just say, you know what? If you're qualified, you get it. It doesn't matter. We don't care. And then you had other departments that would require you to, like, you know, write a, you know, two-page letter explaining the specific reasons for fear that you have that are unlike any other person's fear. It was extremely subjective. And what it did really when they were implementing those restriction policies is it caused more of a headache than anything else because people would get a restricted license and call and complain about it constantly. They call their legislators, they call their city councilors, and they call the chief and be like, hey, this isn't fair. This isn't right. Some of the chiefs would just say, nope, that's our policy. Too bad. Right. But it was a headache. And I think the way they've gone, and the way that, you know, ultimately the decision was made kind of makes sense, really, at its core, right? That the right to self-defense is exactly what the Second Amendment intended.
Right. Switching gears a little bit, this Bruin decision is going to be the gift that keeps on giving for a long time to come, I think. And we're going to see some states that want to try to buck it, right? Like we've seen Governor Hochul do her Concealed Carry Improvement Act, and that got into some legal gymnastics over the past couple weeks as they implemented this act. And then, you know, there was a couple of gun rights groups that immediately sued. And what ended up happening there?
Sure, absolutely. So that is, so last week we got a decision out of New York, out of the district court, on a preliminary injunction to prevent the implementation of the, you know, revised New York statutes. What I kind of, when I envision it in my head, it's almost like a toddler stamping their feet because they didn't get their way on Bruin. If you're a Second Amendment nerd and you're really into this stuff, I highly recommend taking the time to read that decision. Just Google New York gun decision last week and you'll see it. It's really kind of the first time that a district court judge in federal court has taken the time to try to interpret what the Supreme Court held in the Bruin case, which is there is a now a historical analysis standard where you have to look at the regulation, which burdens the Second Amendment, the right to self-defense, and determine whether there is a historical basis to support that. And the judge really did a very good job, and you don't need to be a lawyer, really, the way he wrote the decision, to really start to understand how they're going to be trying to analyze these things. Now, look, you know, the city appealed the preliminary injunction, and the preliminary injunction was stayed. What that really means is, look, they, you know, what the plaintiffs were trying to say is there's an immediate harm there, and the city's saying, oh, there's no immediate harm. And the three justice panels said, okay, yeah, there's no immediately harm right now. Let's hear more, hear about it. But, again, if you're into this stuff, take a look at that decision because it's really well written and it really kind of gives us a guideline and start thinking about how is that going to be implemented here in Massachusetts. There are, you know, a couple of different things working through the system right now. You know, we've discussed on the case from the FPC and Firearms Policy Coalition, which was filed prior to Bruin, which is attacking the Attorney General's handgun regulations. The lead counsel in Massachusetts is Richard Chambers on that case. He's a great lawyer. I'm just a consultant on the case, but I have helped out in the past on it. You know, that at first it was when it was initially litigated, it was dismissed because it's looking at the issue under the intermediate scrutiny standard, which the Bruin case, the Supreme Court has said, no, you're wrong. Don't do that. So it's likely to get remanded back to district court, and a district court judge here is going to have to make the same kind of analysis that New York did. Is there a historical basis to say that you can't carry a Glock handgun because it doesn't have, you know, a little red dot on it that tells you that it's loaded?
Right.
How are they going to prove that? How are the Attorney General's office going to prove that? It's a very interesting question.
Right. I tell you what, these are two cases for us to follow. We're really excited about where this could head and where it could lead. Jason, how can people find you if they want to follow your work and if they need your assistance in any type of Second Amendment case here in Massachusetts?
Yeah, absolutely. So my website is www.lawguida.com. It's lawguida.com. 2a@lawguida.com is my email, and my Facebook is @lawguida. So I often do updates on things that are going on, like the New York case I had an update about last week on my Facebook page, and you can check that out and follow me there.
Awesome. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.
And if you want the best legal protection, go to uscca.com and go to the uscca.com/remote and use code WORKS. That's uscca.com/works and use code WORKS. It's /remote, use code WORKS to get special training, legal advice, and the best legal protection you and your family need. We will be right back. Thanks so much. This is Rapid Fire.